China needs an enemy in order to survive. I get a lot of crap for saying that China only has around about 70 years of history. But the truth of the matter is, the modern China, China that you see today, China with its leadership and Communist Party and everything that goes along with it. And remember, when I say China, I'm usually referring to the way the country works. In other words, government. I'm not talking about your everyman. So anyway, China is only about 70 years old. You will often hear people say 5,000 years of history, you know, etc. But it's not true. During the Cultural Devolution and the Great Leap Backwards, Chinese history was destroyed. And I mean absolutely destroyed, to the point where manuscripts were burnt, you know, libraries torn down, temples, anything to do with the old China was obliterated. It's actually so bad that Chinese doctors that want to study TCM, traditional Chinese medicine, they reach a point where they can no longer continue their studies in China because all the information is lost, that they have to travel to Japan, where, you know, Japanese historians and so on have preserved old traditional medicine recipes from China from way back in the day. So in order to further their studies and complete their studies, they actually have to go to Japan because China no longer has that knowledge. So when you hear this thing about 5,000 years of history, and I'm not trying to denigrate China here, the fact of the matter remains that China does not have a long history. It's kind of like saying that your average Egyptian on the street somehow is linked to the pharaohs and knows everything about the ancient Egyptian knowledge. It's just not the case. All of that stuff was lost. Sure, the country's been there in one form or another in warring states and so on for 5,000 years, but the average man on the street today has about as much history as, well, your average octogenarian. So, let's move on from that and let's move on to this whole enemy thing. Now, I personally love China and I love Chinese people. It's a weird thing because a lot of people don't believe this, and every time I say it, it sounds like I'm just trying to make up for the fact that I'm about to say something bad, but that's actually not the case. I do. I have a Chinese wife, and there are certain Chinese people who are open-minded, especially the youth. We have talked about a guy, you saw it in the live stream yesterday if you watch it, a guy called Simon Yu. He's a good example of the youth of China who have an open mind and they want to express the things they like and the things they dislike about China, etc., etc. You get this, and it's very encouraging and it's awesome. And I absolutely love genuine people like that. But don't forget that communist China, the China we see today, the 70-year-old China, was built on this idea that everyone outside of China, all the foreigners, are bad. And so we Chinese people have to band together in order to fight them. And this is a very, very effective way of gluing society together and having the social cohesion. It's a fantastic tactic. I've seen it myself in play many times in China. So let's quickly rewind a little bit. Let's go all the way back to the Opium Wars. Now, you know, during that time, colonialism and foreign powers were basically running around China, dividing it up amongst themselves and conquering by using opium. Oh no, it's like, you gave us something we like so much that we can't function anymore, you bastards. You know. So anyway, with the Opium Wars, it was in a way a self-inflicted wound, but you also have to understand that it was a forced market and there were all sorts of dastardly things going on. And it is unforgivable what happened in the past. But you know what? It's unforgivable what happened in the past everywhere. Britain, the United States, Germany, all these countries all did dastardly things around the world, and so did a lot of Asian countries. Japan did absolutely awful things in the past. And so we have to realize that this is just a bunch of nonsense that long dead men did a long time ago. It has nothing to do with us today. Anyway, back to my point. Let me try and get back on track here. What happened was China, the communist China, started with this whole idea of, we've been taken advantage of, foreigners are always bullying us, always giving us opium wars, always invading us like Japan, etc. Screw the outside world, they're enemies, we can do everything ourselves, let's block ourselves off, let's build our nation together. Which they actually failed rather miserably at, I'm sorry to say, but if you look at what happened during the Cultural Devolution and the Great Leap Backwards, people were starving in the millions, you know, the industry ground to a halt. It was a terrible, terrible time in China. And it basically plunged the entire country into poverty. Now, you can lay the blame on whoever you want, but the fact of the matter is that during those dark years, China was not doing very well. Anyway, Now we're in modern China. Things have changed due to China opening up, with Deng Xiaoping opening up to the West and bringing in special economic zones like Shenzhen. The economy has grown because of, number one, a hell of a lot of help from the outside world. Whether China, well, China doesn't want to admit that because that goes against the narrative. Number two, the industrious, hardworking Chinese people as well. Because you can give somebody an opportunity, but if they don't take advantage of it and don't do anything with that opportunity, it's worthless. You know, I've used that analogy before. If you put a lump of clay in front of someone, they can either make a sculpture out of it or they can throw it in the trash. So anyway, Chinese people are industrious enough, intelligent enough, smart enough to have built this really powerful economy. Anyway, now back to my personal experience. I have noticed that every single time there's some kind of a political turmoil in China, let's just say some big corruption scandal like the Bo Xiaolai thing, you know, all of a sudden, as it starts to, you know, get into the news and stuff, all of a sudden there'll be this outrage against Japan. And they'll say, oh, the Japanese are trying to steal our island, you know, our Diaoyu Dao. Then the whole country gets whipped into this like anti-Japanese fervor. You have protests everywhere. And it's kind of funny that protests are encouraged and allowed when it's, you know, in these kind of situations. But any other kind of situation, you are not allowed to protest in China. You will get detained, locked up. If you try to protest against your, I don't know, your peer-to-peer lending company stealing your money and you go to the government, or you protest against anything to do with the local Chinese government or problems domestically, forget about it. You're going to get bullied, you're going to get visited by the police, you'll get locked up, all sorts of nonsense. But when they make these big things about Japan or about other countries, like, oh, America's sailing through our China nine-dot line sea or something, and then it's great. Let's go smash our iPhones. Everybody, let's go have a big party and make a big riot. So, you see, this is a very, very, very good tactic to keep the country together, you know, and basically for the government to stay in power and to control the people and stop them getting unruly, because as soon as they start to get unruly towards the government, suddenly blame is cast onto the outside world, which then takes everyone's mind off the government and draws them together as a nation. Now, how do they keep this going? How do they keep stoking the hatred? Fairly simple. If you turn on TV in China, every single day, all day, there are channels playing these War of the Resistance dramas, which are basically fantasy, I call them war fantasy dramas, because nothing that happened in those dramas ever happened in real life. And you turn that on and you'll start to see, you know, sort of Chinese farmer heroes fighting against the Japanese, and you'll get someone with a bow and arrow killing like a million Japanese in one go, and you'll see the Japanese doing all these terrible things, you know, obviously just Chinese actors pretending to be Japanese. But it's relentless. It's kind of like if you were to turn on the TV every day and see a movie about the Nazis doing the Holocaust every single day, but a fantasy one where like you'll get a Holocaust victim jumping up and, you know, destroying a whole concentration camp with a rock or something. You know, it's just mind-bogglingly blown out of proportion and crazy. So this leads to, you know, with the current situation with Huawei, etc., it leads to all these stupid statements by the Chinese government saying America's trying to bully us, they're hurting the feelings of the Chinese people by not letting us sell our product or not doing this and that and the next thing. Rather than treating it in a mature way, sitting down at a table and, you know, talking proper trade, allowing courts to enforce IP rights, things like that, China will rather rile up this anti-America or anti-Japan or anti-foreigner rhetoric. I've seen it so many times in China that, you know, people wouldn't really believe it unless you've seen it. And again, I want to give a few examples that I personally experienced myself. Now, the first time that I experienced this in earnest was just before the 2008 Olympics. Now, remember, this was a massive thing for China, and that this is the first time China's going to get the spotlight of the world, you know, within its borders. So they were preparing a lot of stuff. And to the lead up, during the lead up to the Olympics, of course, you have the torchbearers running around. And as these torchbearers went through certain countries, I think it was France, correct me if I'm wrong down in the comments, I think it was France or one of these European countries, some pro-Tibetan protesters tried to douse the flame, so they went with fire extinguishers while the Chinese athlete was running, or I think even in a wheelchair or something. So these guys came up, they tried to douse the Olympic torch. And of course it made massive headline news in China. It was a big thing. These damn French people are trying to prevent us from growing and trying to stop China from being great. And during that time, and it was only for a couple of days, less than a week, but when I walked out on the street, all the friendly faces that were normally friendly were incredibly, I don't know how to, scary, that's the word. I would walk down and the guy that I normally buy my cigarettes, well, not cigarettes, what am I saying, my beer, I'm not a smoker, but you know, he sells cigarettes too. Guy I normally buy my beer from, he's always got a smile on his face, just looked at me with like a death stare. I couldn't understand what was going on because I wasn't keeping up with the news. Everywhere I walked, people were staring at me. There was this aggressive stance to the point where I felt really uncomfortable walking around for those couple of days that I actually ended up staying either in the office or at home. I didn't want to be going out, especially not going out drinking or something, because if people got drunk, you know, then this stuff could come to the forefront. You know, I'd actually completely forgotten something which I must add here. During that time when the Olympic torch was being doused, etc., etc., when the Olympic torch was to be run through Shenzhen, I was actually studying at the Shenzhen University. And I remember I came in the morning, I actually planned to go and watch it, I wanted to watch it. I came into the university for class in the morning, like everyone else, and we were given an announcement after our first couple of classes that what was going to happen is the university was going to be locked, and all the foreign students had to either leave now or stay inside the university. They were not allowed to leave. So if you wanted to get out of the university, you'd had to leave earlier, and you either had that choice, either get out of there or get locked inside, and you wouldn't be allowed to leave. And this was only for the foreigners. And thinking back, it's quite ridiculous. My friend and I, I've actually got some footage here. We got inside a taxi and we kind of ducked down and we tried to film as we went past. But it was very hostile towards foreigners to the point where foreigners weren't even allowed to leave the university to watch the torch carrying procession. So we went all the way to kind of a foreign bar and hung out there for the rest of the day. But it was very uncomfortable. And we weren't allowed to go and watch the actual torch-bearing ceremony. And, of course, it was down to paranoia because they were afraid that foreigners were going to try and put out the torch or do something to disrupt the ceremony. That was the first time I saw this whole, like, hatred and us versus them kind of cohesion, you know. And I saw how effective it is because it can be turned on and off like a tap, you know. When I was teaching students back in the day, I was teaching a 17-year-old boy, and this guy was fantastic, bright, young, smart boy, and he was really into Japanese stuff. He loved Japanese, you know, cartoons, and he loved, you know, anime. He loved the manga. So when he came to class, he used to be reading Japanese manga, etc., etc. Then, you know, China released one of those. Very typical anti-Japanese movies, but a big blockbuster one it was called. I think it was Nanjing was the name of it, right? Which of course documents the Nanjing Massacre, which is a disgusting stain on the history of humanity, never mind any country. And he went to go and see this, and he came to class the next day, and he didn't have his manga or anything, and he told me that he burnt all of his Japanese manga, he'd thrown away all his Japanese stuff, and now he hates Japanese people. And I was like, you know, there's no place in this world for that kind of hate. You know, you have to recognize these things happened in the past. We have the same thing with both the Nazis and the Japanese. You know, having family members who fought and died in the war during World War II myself, it is easy to hold on to the hate, but there's no point. I have no animosity towards German people today because of what some assholes did in the past. You know, but unfortunately, the way China works is they stoke the hatred so much towards foreigners that real hate and animosity is still alive today. And it's being used as a government tool to keep the nation together. So that's why China needs enemies. If China didn't have enemies, foreign enemies, I honestly think that the whole Chinese society would fall apart because people would start seeing the problems in front of them and start trying to address them. There'd be probably like revolts. There'd probably be people like, we don't want to put up with this anymore, you know, because the government doesn't let people do what they want. The government tells them what they can do. You know what I mean? At the end of the day. So that's why China needs enemies. Thank you very much for watching, guys. I really appreciate it, and I can't wait to see you in the next one. Until then, you know the drill. As always, stay awesome, and another Serpents a Day next Friday, right here. Lao 86 every Wednesday, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Most importantly, we've got ADV China down here every single Monday, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, but we have something new. We have our live show, which is every second Thursday. If you haven't seen it yet, please go check it out. It's a lot of fun. I think you'll enjoy it.